What is love?
I love you.
How much I still love you.
I have a love in my life.
Yeah. Do you love me?
Perhaps the more important question to ask is, why is love? Bet you thought I was gonna reference that Hathaway song from 1993 in the first line back there. And you're right, I probably should have. Missed opportunity. Sorry. It's just, I can't stop thinking about As Time Goes By. It's a song from Casablanca. There's this line in it, actually a pair of lines, that goes,
"Moonlight and love songs are never out of date."
Yeah, like that. And it got me thinking. Has love always been the same? Specifically, have people always thought of love in the way I have since I was about 5 up until right now, writing this video, listening to my girlfriend sleep? She's going to a play tomorrow. So I did some reading, and the short answer is sort of. Turns out people have been arguing over what love is almost nonstop since 400-something BC, when Empedocles proposed his theory of the four elements. The basic gist of his theory was there are two cosmic forces in this life. Those are love, philetus, and strife, nekos. Love is the force of attraction and combination, and strife is the force of repulsion and fragmentation. His theory proposed that these two forces are engaged in an eternal clash, and they each prevail briefly, pirouetting around one another in an endless cosmic cycle. Light and dark, good and evil, yin and yang, Dave and Buster's. Anyways, this cycle is what caused the four elements, otherwise existing alone and without cause to change, to collide with one another and become different, something more. Empedocles' proposed struggle was a play in four acts. The prevailing act of love, the transition from love to strife, the prevailing act of strife, and finally the transition from strife back to love. According to Empedocles, the world we live in existed and will always exist in continuous movement through this play. Love, therefore, is the reason for everything. What made Shakespeare write Sonnet 65 and made Cleopatra take Mark Antony's side against Octavian and later commit suicide with him is the same reason Scooby-Doo meets the Harlem Globetrotters exists. And as much as I adore The Shop Around the Corner or Casablanca or Punch Drunk Love, I don't think any of my favorite romance films or their directors ever properly captured the omnipotence of love that Empedocles imagined. That is, until the first time I saw Perfect Blue. I fell in love instantly with Satoshi Kon's work, and not long after, I made it a point to watch through everything he had ever directed. What I found was that everything Satoshi touched was based wholly, totally in love. Satoshi's filmography, more than any other director, embodies what Empedocles envisioned love to be. God. Anyways, that's what I'm going to spend this 5-part series talking cool about, so put on your thinking caps and strap in. I'm really smart, and this is Satoshi Kon, and Why Love Is All You Need.
Love me, love me, love me, say you do. Let me fly away with you.
Alright, so we already established that Satoshi Kon's works are a reflection of Empedocles' theory of the elements. But no mirror is without imperfection, and the reflection we're shown by Kon is just a tiny bit different. Postmodern, pre-Socratic, if you will. There's this thing called triangular theory, written by this guy, Robert Sternberg, about the L word and what makes it tick. Sternberg suggests that there are three fundamentals of which all love is born. Intimacy, passion, and commitment. What Satoshi proposes is closer to the core of love, but more broad in its strokes. Satoshi proposes the states of love itself. These four states are the pursuit of love, the possession of love, the loss of love, and the absence of love. Still Empedocles' cycle, just remastered. It's not DuckTales, it's DuckTales HD. So using this handy-dandy redux of Empedocles' theory, we're able to categorize every major character throughout Satoshi's body of work, and what influences every decision they make. Love and the absence of it are the only true cosmic forces that exist within Kon's work. They are everything. With that out of the way, it's time we dive into Kon's very first foray onto the silver screen. Perfect Blue. Originally intended to be a live-action, direct-to-VHS series, but later changed to a feature-length animation. After its budget was lanced following the Kobe earthquake of 1995, Perfect Blue was adapted from Yoshikazu Takeuchi's novel Perfect Blue Complete Metamorphosis, about a young idol fighting against the restrictions of her innocent image by reimagining her identity as a woman whose body is her own. But in doing so, has sent one of her obsessive fans, not believing it could truly be her, on a psychotic crusade to restore his pure idol. By whatever means necessary. Feeling unsure if the live-action screenplay adapted from the novel would genuinely make a compelling film, Kon and his screenwriter Sadayuki Murai actually asked Takeuchi if they could change the contents of his work to better fit the narrative they'd envisioned. Takeuchi consented under the condition Kon maintained a few of the original elements of his novel, and just like that, due to an earthquake and a considerably lenient author, Satoshi Kon's cult psychological thriller slash coming-of-age film slash condemnation of idol culture was born. But wait, what is idol culture? Idol culture is actually a craze that gained its traction in Japan following the success of and infatuation with a French musician named Sylvie Vartan during the mid-60s. Sylvie had risen to pop prominence in France, being marketed as the twisting schoolgirl. After some back-to-back hits on the French charts and an international hit in Japan, her innocent pixie dream image landed her a spot in Michel Boyron's 1963 film, Je cherche les idoles. The film touched down in Japan the following year, and the term idol started being used to describe any cute-looking musician or actress, and the Japanese pop culture and marketing monolith was born. Idol culture was and is comprised of two equally strange and ethically gray halves, the Idoru and the Shinitai. Idoru are the idols, young teenage pop artists who are discovered by agencies, often through live audition shows, to become manufactured and heavily scripted pop group members. Not using manufactured as a buzzword to criticize pop artists, either. I literally mean they are engineered to accommodate market trends. Everything from their hobbies, to their outings, to who they were seen with, to how they dressed, were regulated and rehearsed by the production companies that assigned them. What separates a group like, say, AKB48 or Morning Musume from other J-pop artists like Kota Kumi or Utada Hikaru is predominantly an issue of marketing. See, the most crucial part to being an idol is the illusion of purity. More specifically, the purity that comes with youth. Idols were constructed and marketed to be paragons of innocence, and the Japanese market bought in hard. Being an idol meant you were the primary vehicle of marketing in Japan, but still made a relatively poor wage because the size of your group and the contract you were under entitled your production company, promoters, choreographers, writers, and stylists to an overwhelming majority of your profits. And despite surprisingly low pay, you were marketed to the public as living an above-average, if not lavish, life. Idols existed under near constant surveillance from their promoters, and once they had grown too old-looking or were spotted with a significant other in public, most idols were immediately released from their contracts and removed from their groups, oftentimes debilitating them from ever pursuing solo careers due to the harsh backlash from their fanbase for what they perceived to be a decline into impurity. Which brings us to the second half of this bizarre whole, the Shinitai. Literally translating to bodyguards in Japan, the fandoms behind individual idols were less like fans and more like feverishly devoted cheerleaders for the image the production companies had manufactured for them. Shinitai sounds more honorable than it is though, so going forward from here, I'm going to call them otaku. Anyways, these otaku would attend concerts, buy magazines, sign up for chat rooms, and attend fan clubs, not even for specific groups, but often for a specific idol they cheered on within that group. They would regularly attend concerts and arrange queues to systematically cheer for their idol, shouting the idol's name, having a call and response for each song, throwing confetti on stage at specific times during their performance, and so forth. The relationship between idols and the otaku that closely followed them was one of feverish love and devotion. but also one of distinct callousness and disconnection. Because what the otaku were really attached to were images that the performers would invariably outgrow or otherwise be unable to maintain. A lot has changed in the years since Perfect Blue's release, but at least when it was current, the idol world was a neatly gift-wrapped echo of Imperial Japan's oppressive and restrictive ideas of what a woman should be, young, bright, and subservient, projected onto its rapidly developing post-World War II society. Alright, now that our frame of context has been set, it's time to hit play. From this point forward, I'm gonna break down how Kon hoodwinks, deceives, and leads us through the wacky worlds of idol culture and dissociative identity disorder. First stop on our trip, let's talk lighting and color theory. Throughout Perfect Blue, there are two motifs Satoshi calls upon ad nauseum that mostly slip under the radar of our consciousnesses, despite their repetition. Those are the juxtaposition of reds and blues, and the instantaneous, incongruous change in exposure between shots. Perfect Blue opens with a Super Sentai stage production, pretty closely resembling Himetsu Sentai Goringer, nearing its end in front of a crowd of fairly underwhelmed faces. Right out of the gate, Satoshi introduces us not only to the contrast between reds and blues, but to the overwhelming predominance of blues in this film. The Red Ranger is not only surrounded by much colder, less vibrant colors, but even the stage he's cast against is a myriad of icy blues. A few cuts later, using these running kids as our line of continuity between the shots, we hurriedly arrive at our first stop on our quick tour of idol culture insight. Three men standing beside a Cham poster, the group our protagonist Mima belongs to, discussing the excessive expense of an exclusive mini-disc, one featuring Mima singing in place of her bandmate. Before we're given a chance to hear anything expressly positive about the group, we discover the reason Mima had to replace her bandmate. Otaku in the crowd had been harassing her to the point where she couldn't sing. The tone Doughboy here delivers this information in, feeling like it's somewhere between the provinces of joy and criticism. This, followed by his next line, now excitedly lamenting what a precious example of Mima's singing voice it is, perfectly establishes the dynamic between idol culture, in this case Mima, and its fanbase, one of indelicacy and obsession. What's more important than how unempathetic and simultaneously fanatical adult men are towards girls likely much younger than them, though, is the surroundings they're cast against while they express it. The most brilliant color in this shot, and consequently the strongest influence as to how we feel during it, is the lustrous, incandescent red bench that the trio is perched in front of. This lucent warmth, in contrast with the pale and washed out yellows, oranges, and the still overwhelming presence of blues that I mentioned earlier, is the visual representation of this dynamic. There is love present here, sure, a flashing and fervent passion for the group they're discussing, but it is nonetheless surrounded by colors that represent callousness, detachment, and fatigue. The only other semblances of warmth present, feeling washed out and distant. A few more shots of Otaku displaying the same behavior as Larry, Curly, and Mo over here later, and it's time for Cham's big performance. As the curtain opens and the idols race onto the stage, the entire crowd, despite their cheerful and boisterous demeanor, are completely surrounded by the same cold blues and greens that has surrounded the three J-pop musketeers and their bench earlier in the sequence. Additionally, the stage behind Cham, as well as the girls themselves, have replaced the bench and become the new visual contrast to the overwhelming presence of blues that previously dominated the venue. Rather than the reds, pinks, and whites representing love, innocence, and purity, the colors Cham are cast against and the colors they are dressed in only represent the illusion of these sensations. Because this is a performance. It's quite literally staged, and this stage is still the one we were shown in the first shot of the film. One comprised of melancholy and passivity. The crowd reaction has changed, certainly, from the tokusatsu performance we were ushered into the film by, but their surroundings haven't. We are only given the illusion of warmth through a change in gels over the lights. The girls are draped in colors as warm and as bright as they are delicate, but Kon introduces us to them seconds before this, riddled with anxiety and stress. Every line they deliver to us served with indignation as its garnish. Cham and the other idols are nothing more than a very complex heat lamp, but instead of infrared radiation, they project what their image represents, love, purity, passion, faithfulness, innocence, and empathy onto their fans. Satoshi's use of this complementary color palette throughout the film illustrates and then continues to hammer into our subconscious that Mima is not a three-dimensional person to her followers. She is a light source. Speaking of light sources, it's as good of time as any to talk about color theory's best friend, lighting. Following this disorienting interpolation of shots between Mima's performance and her commute home, Kon takes us from Josie and the Pussycats to Anomalisa, almost in an instant, as we're given one of our first looks at how he uses lighting within a shot, specifically overexposure, to weave nearly seamlessly between Mima's reality and Mima's delusions. And what makes this means of deception so compelling is that it is not one we are ever completely cognizant of as it happens. Satoshi intoxicates and misleads us, often without us ever making a conscious note of it. At least, not on a first watch. Here, you'll see what I mean in a second. Watch this.
そっちは?あ、そうなん。え?うん、今日が最後やったんや。歌はもう歌わん。また アイドルのイメージはもう息苦しいんや。それに今はアイドルなんか。待って、電話が入ったけん。はい、切り声ですけど。もしもし?もしもし?もう。あ、お母さん?うん、なんか間違いやった。うん、わかっちょん。ちょっと待って、お風呂のお湯が
5分したらかけて。Catch anything? No? Mima just fabricated half of this conversation. Notice the cut to this shot right here, where the lighting becomes way more exposed for basically no reason, similar to the shots of Cham running out on stage earlier. This marks the precise moment that we depart from reality. The only warm or comforting or even vaguely positive parts of this conversation between Mima and her mom are in these overexposed shots, and we can't hear a word from her. She isn't saying anything. We can hear her mom in this shot, and we can hear her in the following shot when the exposure returns to normal, as she criticizes Mima's decision to pursue acting. Yet, not a single word is spoken by her for this stretch of time, or this one here. And it's because they didn't take place. This didn't happen. The pieces of this conversation that Mima fabricates are very basic expressions of love, like Mima asking her mom how she's doing and following up with her answer excitedly, then answering her mom when she returns the question. The reason nothing can at first be assumed of this exchange is due to Satoshi's disorienting means of guiding us into the film, coupled with the fact that it's an almost mundane baseline interaction that most of us have shared with our parents countless times. I mean, really, who would need to fabricate something so simple? Why would this be where the psychological thriller begins? We're still in front-loaded exposition mode, aren't we? As the conversation progresses past this seemingly cheerful exchange, we cut back to a lower exposure, lower angle shot, reality, and Mima's mother is decidedly less happy sounding and much more critical than the interaction they just had would let on. The only parts of this interaction that are firmly, or as firmly as they can be, planted in reality is Mima picking up the phone, her mom exclaiming that she's home, and then Mima, with a blank and despondent expression, being criticized for her career change and told, not so subtly, that she had let down the rest of her family. That's it. Mima, and by proxy the audience, fall comfortably into this delusion that she has a warmer and more loving family life than she actually does. As the film progresses, the detachments from reality become oftentimes much more grandiose and abstract. But this is where they take root, from the loss and soon the complete absence of love. Mima's delusions are her only means at this point to soften the edge of reality and repackage it into something that's easier to handle. Presumably this gargoyle from earlier beeps in, and after hanging up on his heavy breathing from Wes Craven's Scream phone call, we transition back to the overexposed shot from earlier, slipping back into Mima's delusion. Not to discuss the disturbing call she just received, not to discuss her career choices, but simply to have some semblance of a warm end to the conversation with her mom. Going back to color for a moment, another excellent example of Satoshi's use of red and blue in this film can be found in this sequence here during the film's bait climax, where Mima is almost raped by her ghoulish number one fan slash stalker slash the deuteragonist of Perfect Blue, Mimania. Kon ushers us into what is, in my opinion, the second most important scene in the film by way of this hallway. Using it both as a massive, cold surface to cast a reflection of Mima's identity, another motif Kon plays heavily on throughout this film, and as a structure to represent idol culture and the transition from it, a seemingly endless tunnel of blues and greens with interspersed glimpses of reds and yellows. Following a masterfully timed cut on action from Mimania's arm to the closing of Rumi's trunk, and this brief interaction between a now completely stoic Rumi and an altogether disconnected Totokoro, we're taken back to the location where Mima had to film her traumatizing rape scene. Finally completing the postponed movement of his arm from this shot, Mimania plunges a knife into the foreground just inches away from Mima's face, and cutting her reaction short, Kon throws us to the rafters to observe this assault from above. Just like the shot of Cham taking the stage in the intro sequence of the film, the adoring otaku, this time just one in number, is surrounded on all sides by the visual manifestation of his loneliness. This time, the blues and greens being so heavily shadowed that this shot creates an atmosphere more resonant of death than it is of melancholia. Cut back to the stage, this time a medium two-shot of the struggling girl and ghoul, and a dazzling curtain of scarlet-red is finally fully revealed behind them. The light produced seemingly by Mima herself, again not dissimilar from her opening performance in the film, seems to react to the presence of the curtain once it's become fully visible to us, and the blues that had previously bathed the stage are transformed to an arrangement of purples, used especially in horror films as a representation of the ethereal and a detachment from reality. Once Mimania believes he's knocked Mima unconscious and that the struggle is over, the love Mima had been pursuing for the last leg of the film, represented by the scarlet curtain, starts to wane as the blue begins to overtake its luster within the shot, dulling its fluorescence into a bluish maroon gradient. And then finally, at what is arguably the true apex of the film's tension, the love for herself that Mima had been pursuing amidst this exhaustive delirium that we've been living with her through, is finally within reach, manifesting itself in this strike to her nightmarish assailant's head. Mimania's last breath, a panicked half whimper, falls from his lips as he's cast against a backdrop of a now restored brilliant red, mirroring his idol in the beginning of the film. As Mima stands over his now lifeless body, her face and the curtain behind it start to gleam, while light begins to flood the frame, cueing us into Mima's delusion for the very last time. The Doublebind crew, setting her aglow with their lighting equipment, are the only people there to congratulate her in her moment of triumph. And although we find out soon after this that Mimania's death isn't truly the end of her worries, nor was it seemingly real, it still marks the end of Mima's psychosis, and it's an end that deserves to be celebrated. Even if there's no one left to celebrate it with, except us. Which brings us back to here. What is, in my opinion, the most important scene in Perfect Blue. This 1 minute and 28 second span of runtime right here. After a brief scene from Doublebind, we transition through the television it's been playing on and into Tetakoro's office while the scene is being rewinded. Tadakoro and Rumi are continuing their discourse about whether or not Mima should have left Cham to pursue her career as an actress, and we've just butted into the middle of it. Tadakoro seems considerably less convicted than he acts around Mima before or after this, now expressing that he's done all he can and that this is the point where Mima will just have to prove herself as an actress, while Rumi speaks about her with a very distinct objectivity that has been absent in her approach to Mima leading up to this point. Rumi insists that Mima should essentially retcon her previous decision and go back to being sold as a pop idol. Tadakoro counters Rumi by saying that things aren't the same as when she was an idol, and rather than argue in Mima's stead, Rumi responds dejectedly and with a longing expression on her face. From this point forward, her intentions with Mima and feelings towards her are laid out for us, transparent as can be. She used to be an idol too, and she badly wishes she still could be. Rumi suffers from the absence of love. The image she casts onto Mima, which she eventually inhabits as an alternate persona, becomes her vehicle for her pursuit of the love she lacks. If she can't live as an idol anymore as Rumi, she'll live as one vicariously through Mima. 20 minutes into the film's runtime, and we're given most of the dots we need to connect to know Rumi's a shady bitch, but that's small potatoes compared to what happens next. Keep an eye on Tadakoro's hands when we cut to the next shot. See that? His bandages are gone. In an instant. There's no time lapse, no explanation for it. But the lighting changes. Notice the change in exposure between this shot and the one that follows. With the return of the exposure, so too do his bandages return. But following this scene, Tadakoro is never seen with them again. Whew. All right, there's a lot to unpack here, so bear with me. Earlier in the film, on Mima's first day on the double-blind set, Kon employs the same trick he used in her phone conversation we talked about earlier and in the scene we just watched. As a matter of fact, the exposure and vibrancy of colors change between cuts in around half the shots on set. And Kon continues to do this every time we visit the double-blind set for the duration of the film. So we have a ton of shots weaved throughout this film that are deliberately overexposed, or at the very least extremely harshly lit, in contrast to previous shots in the same area for seemingly no reason. Except now we know why Satoshi does it. Overexposure or very hard lighting are his visual cues for psychosis. This isn't a one-off visual trick, this is a rule. And every time Mimania is seen in the film, it is within these windows. So back to the first day on the double-blind set. What is in frame right before the envelope detonates in Tetakoro's hands? Mima, who hasn't moved a muscle since slipping into another psychotic episode back here, repeating the phrase, "Who are you?" to herself. Certainly not to remember her lines, as Rumi comments earlier, because that's her only line. She's repeating it for the same reason she repeats it in the initial transition to the double-blind set. And the reason every transition to the double-blind set from the beginning to the end of this film is kickstarted by Mima questioning her identity. We're not in reality right now. Which means this attack never happened. Or rather, it did, but it happened within an episode of Mima's psychosis. This entire film reticulates back and forth between two realities. The real world, denominated by softer, dimmer lighting and harsher, less kind treatment from those Mima cares about, and the collective delusion of perfect blue, visually designated by its very harsh, very bright lighting. A delusion that Mima and the audience has begun to live inside of. So, if the attack never happened, how come Rumi and Tadakoro both respond to her when she mentions it? More than that, actually, why do both of them try to immediately stifle her mentioning it to others? And in such an uncaring, bizarre tone and expression? And both when they're surrounded by the color red? Alright, for us to go any further, it's time we talk about music. Perfect Blue's score, much like the film itself, is separated into two polarizing halves, both arranged by composer Masahiro Ikumi. Now, here's what's interesting about this separation. One half of the score, the red side of Perfect Blue, is comprised of four pop anthems written by Masahiro and performed by Cham, or the vocalist representing Mima specifically, all titled the way you would expect songs to be titled on an actual pop album. Angel of Love, Cherish These Moments, etc. But the other half of Masahiro's score, the blue side of Perfect Blue, are titled like theme songs, each composition being named after one of the three main characters they were written to underscore and represent in the film. Except this one. We have Mima, we have virtual Mimas, and we have Mimanias. So, which character was Nightmare written for? Nightmare was written for us. Nightmare is the audience's theme song because the film is structured like one, and we are its fourth main character. And here's where it gets tricky. Theme songs are leitmotifs, meaning they are typically short, consistently recurring musical phrases associated with a particular person, place, or concept within a narrative. So when we hear... we think Superman, even if Superman hasn't appeared on screen yet. So what does Nightmare underscore in Perfect Blue then, and how does it grow to represent us? Nightmare only plays during the peaks of Mima's delusion. Following her partly fabricated conversation with her mom, during the explosive incident that damages Tadakura's hands, when Mima discovers the diary entries in Mima's room, all the way up to when Mimania attacks her. In fact, Nightmare is actually the most consistent piece of music in Perfect Blue, by a factor of like three. It grows to represent this misapprehension, this misbelief in the reality we're presented, because the audience is sharing in the delusion too. There's this French psychiatric term that I'm probably going to butcher the pronunciation of here, called folie à deux. It means madness of two, or shared psychosis, and it is a term used to describe patients in which their symptoms of delusional belief or hallucination have been transmitted from or to them. The folie we're dealing with, though, is a quatre, the madness of four. And the characters sharing in this delusion are Rumi, underscored by virtual Mima, Mima, underscored by Mima's theme, the audience, underscored by Nightmare, and Tadakoro, underscored by Uchida's theme. The reason his bandages disappear with the shift between exposures earlier is because he's a part of the delusions too. Saido, the pike bishop of the otaku wild bunch that harassed Cham at their shows, is the only other character in the film who in any way acknowledges or interacts with Mimania's presence. And it's with the acknowledgement only a few lines into their brief interaction that Mimania is not who he appears to be all the time. This interruption of the concert does actually happen. The event itself takes place in reality. But every time Mimania's face is in frame, the lighting becomes much harder and brighter than the shots these shots cut from and to. Mimania, just like real Mima, only exists in Mima's delusions. The themes are written for the appearances of Rumi and Tadakoro, because Rumi and Tadakoro are the only other main characters in Perfect Blue, besides Mima in the audience. Rumi and Tadakoro seek control over Mima's life, both expressing this through their fragmented, subversive personalities that take hold of them. And their behavior with regards to Mima implies this dynamic since the start of the film. Notice the amount of anger in Tadakoro at the sight of people attempting to harass Mima, willing to shut down the concert to avoid any damage being brought to her, in contrast to Rumi's concern that it would look bad if they canceled Mima's final performance with Cham. Tadakoro covets the image of Mima. Rumi covets Mima's image. It is Tadakoro's guilt over tarnishing his image of Mima and fervent love for it that drives him, not Rumi, to kill both Murano and Shibuya. Because it's Tadakoro's theme that plays during the iconic murder scene. Not Rumi's, not Mima's. Masahiro's score of Perfect Blue is the only consistent means of discerning character from character and delusion from reality in the film, aside from Kon's use of lighting and color. It both accentuates the delusions we're experiencing and lets us know that what we're experiencing is delusion. This isn't Mima, but it isn't Rumi either. We're just meant to retrospectively assume this was Rumi. Masahiro and Kon are telling us this is a false resolution through their use of Tadakoro's theme. Mima's theme, coming into the foreground as she shatters a cup in her hand to see if she's real, is our means of knowing that this entire interaction and visit didn't happen. Mima is real, but this isn't. The blood drops into the tea, but the tea remains exactly the same hue and lightness, because the blood never dropped. Her theme continues playing over the rest of the sequence because these two are delusions. Mima didn't go shopping in Harajuku, but both her and the audience lack the confidence in her mental stability to be certain. The detectives from Doublebind accusing Mima of being the culprit behind the murders that Tadakoro and Rumi have planned and carried out is merely a reflection of Rumi and Tadakoro's continuous insistence that Mima not worry or talk about the attacks. Mima's theme is one of paranoia and delusion reaching a fever pitch. Rumi's theme, playing during the second and final crest of the film, is perhaps the best example of how Masahiro's compositions are used not to underscore reality, but to underscore the deviation from it. What makes this chase sequence the best example of it is that it is the only time that both the audience and Mima are outside of the delusion. As we watch the chase unfold, from its start to its finish, Rumi is shown in reflections to be who Mima and the audience know she is, Rumi Hidaka. What we see of her outside of her reflections during her pursuit, though, is who Rumi has deluded herself into thinking she is, the real Mima. The moment Rumi's delusion is torn away from her by Mima, her final revolt against the paranoia and the absence of love she had suffered through for the past hour and 15 minutes, Rumi's theme instantly stops playing. With Mima's convicted declaration that she is the real Mima, at the end of Kon's final use of Masahiro's themes, Mima finally possesses the love she had lost at the start of the film. This time, however, the love's foundations are within herself, not in the image projected onto her by an industry she felt trapped inside of, or the people who wished for her to stay in it. With the last scene of the film, we see Mima sat in a relucent red car following her visit paid to Rumi, looking at her reflection with a sense of confidence that had been absent since the beginning of the film. Once again, Mima is framed with blues and greens, but this time, their brilliance and vibrance accentuate the positive associations with these colors, like growth and tranquility. Perfect Blue is easily the most psychologically dense film Satoshi Kon ever made, and Mima shares this attribute. She is the only character in any of Satoshi's works to circumnavigate his cycle of love, from possession to loss to absence to pursuit and back into possession. Our journey with Mima is one that is as fulfilling and encouraging as it is disorienting and harrowing. Satoshi's command of lighting and transitions, his masterful use of color, and his employment of Masahiro's compositions as the only source of consistent balance in the film offer a biting criticism of the idol industry as it was in the 90s, and a meditation on the transformative properties of love. Kon's use of motifs in Perfect Blue is also not to be underrated. His constant references to the number 2, representing the folie à deux and further implying the existence of not one split personality but two, going even so far as to name the television show that Mima acts on Double Bind. The biblical punishment of gouging out one's eyes for looking upon a woman in lust that Tadakoro and eventually Rumi mete out on their victims. The continual use of televisions, monitors, and camera lenses as waygates into a different reality and means of escapism. And the perpetual references to self-identity through the reflections of our main characters all come together to form a dreadful, dreamy delirium, driven by love that can ensnare and surprise you with each watch, as if you'd never seen it before. Perfect Blue is Satoshi Kon's argument that love, in the absence of it, can consume you and those around you, either elevating you beyond any heights you'd ever dreamed of or stripping you of any semblance of happiness you once had. But no matter the depth of your fall or the peak of your ascent, there will always be another mountain, and there will always be another valley. Because life is just a cycle of reds and blues. Yo, thanks for watching the first episode of my little 5-part mini-series here. Had a ton of fun writing it. Next episode, we'll be jumping into Millennium Actress, so hope you stick around for that. It'll be somewhere on this screen once it's out. Let me know what you think about what I thought down below. Like and subscribe, please. And Patreon, come through and support the channel. Love you, love you, love you. Have a good night.